Then. 0141 951 1025. It's time to talk football. It's Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Good evening and welcome to Clyde One Super Scoreboard. The Old Firm build-up continues with just 3 days to go. Dundee say their pitch is playable despite rain concerns, and Stuart Kettlewell says it's business as usual at Motherwell despite advancing takeover talks. I'm Andrew McLean. Joining me in the studio tonight is Gordon DL and Mark Wilson.
Well, the build-up is well and truly here for the game on Sunday, one of the most eagerly anticipated Rangers Celtic games that I can remember in a long time, purely because the way the league table is sitting now, 1 point between them, not much separating the sides, injured players returning to both squads. It's going to be a fascinating weekend ahead. A lot of good fixtures on Saturday as well, all through the divisions, but the big one on Sunday is where all eyes will be.
Yeah, I agree with Mark. I think all eyes will be in Ibrox Park and Sunday. Looking forward to this game. I hope it's a really exciting game. Two teams that are getting back to probably their strongest squads. A lot of important players coming back for Rangers and Celtic. Be interesting the Rangers line up. I think that if McGregor's fit, we could probably guess what the Celtic one's going to be. And as Mark quite rightly said, on Saturday there's a lot of important games and a lot of points we played for.
Yeah, what point of the build-up are we in? Because I think it is a bit of a roller coaster at times for supporters. They'll maybe start the week quite confident and then there might be a bit of a dip, or people get even more confident as the week goes on. People start picking their team selection as well.
Well, probably a nervous period, not only for supporters, but I think for players as well, because the game just round the corner. You get the weekend's fixtures out the way. For players, you've recovered. For the managers, for the coaches, you see who's now becoming available. When you get 48 hours before the fixture, training the next couple of days will be light. And for supporters, well, there'll be some that will be confident after the weekend. There'll be some that are looking at the opposition side and saying, oh, well, if you're a Rangers fan, McGregor could be back. Hatate played a good chunk of the game. That's looking like it could be Celtic's strongest midfield. If you're a Celtic fan, maybe you're looking at the other side and thinking Sima came back and played a big part. Tavernier scoring again. So Rangers' form from the beginning of the year till now has been good. So it's always an interesting time when you get to now as a player. I loved it. I loved the anticipation of the game. Didn't like the ticket request that you sort of got run a bit now, you know, those last minute requests, but it's a great one to be involved in. And as I said, this one eagerly anticipated because it's really Rangers where a new manager, a new style, a new mentality about them, really putting a challenge down to this Celtic side that may come to the fore on Sunday.
I'm sure the managers will have a good idea in their head of what their 11 is going to look like, but players at this point, ones that have been injured, will certainly be wanting to show in the next couple of days that they're fit enough to start, fit enough to play 60, 90 minutes if they're needed to be called upon.
Every player is desperate to be involved in this. You want to obviously be involved from the start. You want to be walking out that tunnel. But if you're on the bench, you could play an important role, because substitutes now can turn games, win games for you. We've seen that in the past. So you've got to look to be a part of that squad, be a part of that team, be prepared to take the disappointment if you're not playing, but ready to go on and make a difference. And I think both sets, both teams have got that in their locker, because you look at Rangers' bench against Hibs, it was very strong again. Celtic are getting back to their strongest 11 on the pitch. I think both sides are going in a good place, Andrew, to be honest with you. And I'm not surprised that no matter who you meet, if it's a Rangers fan, a Celtic fan, both sets of supporters are confident of a result. Rangers, because of under Clement, it's at Ibrox, all their fans have been there. Celtic, because they know how to go to Ibrox and win, and especially Brendan Rodgers. So I just think we're in for a really exciting weekend.
Well, let's hear from you. 0141 951 1025 is the number you need to get in touch. I'm sure you'll want to tell us about how you're feeling ahead of this big game on Sunday. We were talking a bit about some of the players coming back from injury, the likes of Callum McGregor, the likes of Abdallah Sima. Do the injured players, do they come in and start for you? We want to hear from you. 0141 951 1025. I did hear plenty of suggestions last night about the key men, who you think the key men for your team are going to be on Sunday. So maybe you've got some more suggestions on that. The same number, 0141 951 1025. 951 1025. A couple of more interesting stories as well that have come out today. Dundee's pitch rearing its head again. There were reports of it maybe not being good enough to be played on Saturday. Dundee have now said that it is playable, but it is only Thursday and the game's on Saturday. There's more rain scheduled, I'm sure.
They should have just brought the game forward then, shouldn't they? I thought, it doesn't matter about today. The game's playable now. Like, they've got real issues with that pitch. They have done at the start of the season. Their groundsman was putting gardening leave earlier on. I'm pretty sure, how ironic is that? And it's just went from bad to worse. Now, how bad an advert would it be for our full game if that is to be the case, if another game has to be postponed there? Or I think it'd be even worse if it has to be moved to another ground. I mean, where do they play it? Play at Tannadice across the street on a pitch that's perfect almost? Or do you need to find an artificial pitch
surface somewhere
than the local juniors, Lockheed Juniors or North End, play it on that?
Is that a local high school pitch and see if people can turn
by the way, the rates are the cheap for them.
Indoor in the hall.
Indoor with the yellow five sign ball.
Benches turned on their side as well as goals.
That's when football was brilliant. Those days.
It is a bit of a problem, especially with the fact that their games have been called off before. They've got a problem with their pitch. They'll need to address that, obviously, in the summer, and they certainly will do that. But they have to get through because the split's coming up as well. So the fixtures, they've got to fix the fixtures in somewhere along the line. It'll be interesting to see. Dundee, you're right, I've come out and made a statement today that just now the pitch is playable. Got to take their word for that. And hopefully that it'll be playable against Motherwell at the weekend.
Well, any thoughts on that or anything else? Give us a call, 01419511025. Let's start with Craig, who's a Rangers fan in Moodysburn. Craig, not long to go until the game on Sunday. How are you feeling at the moment?
Hi guys, good evening. Not bad. I never enjoy these games. You know, it's one of the ones you kind of dread it all week, and then you're there, it flies by and the blink of an eye. You never really enjoy it till after, and you're, you know, either in a high or a low for the rest of the week, or maybe that's just me. But my main point was, I was trying to get on a couple of nights ago about the point about who's going to be the main man for each team. I don't know if this has been touched on, but mine is John Lundstrom. I think the way he's been playing, particularly since the new manager came in, has been sensational. I think he's replicating that for me a couple of years ago on the road to Seville, even, dare I say, a bit better. And he's certainly making his tick for this new, you know, style of play we've got. He's sitting in that kind of deep lying playmaker role, and I just think there's another couple, you know, Tav and Cantwell for me. Need by put my teeth back in, stop them guys.
It's just the excitement, isn't it?
I think Cantwell, you know, his best game against Celtic was when it didn't really matter. You know, the game under Michael Beale, the 3-0 game. But we need a performance like that out of him, and I think coming back from injury. But I would say John Lundstrom, for me, if he has a good game, I'm confident we can control the midfield.
Yeah, he's certainly a player that has really improved under Philip Clement. Is he the type of player that Rangers need to have a huge performance on Sunday when that midfield area is so key in these games?
I believe so. I said on Saturday that I think Lundstrom has really been a player that's been transformed. He's had a funny Rangers career, actually, when you think of it. Been up and down, been a fan's favourite. Then we've heard complaints on this show about him that his time was done. But certainly built his way back up under Philippe Clement. He's been excellent recently. But I think that area of the pitch is key. You think of Celtic's dominance throughout the years. When they had Scott Brown in there, nobody could really overshadow him. Cal McGregor then came and took over, and yet again, nobody really overshadowed him in the previous game. It was him that pulled the strings. If Rangers are going to be successful, they need to stop Celtic's better players obviously getting a grip of the game, but they need to overrun them as well and impose themselves. Lundstrom certainly got the ability to do it. Is the big question is him doing it actually on the day, so he'll know the task it lies in front of him. Lundstrom, he's played against McGregor plenty of times, if McGregor's fit, that is, and it's a key area of the pitch. I know the other ones that will grab the headlines, the goal scorers and, you know, the set piece takers, but it's that middle area of the pitch, it's so crucial in these games.
It probably is a testament to his turnaround in form that, you know, there maybe was a time that people would be surprised if a Rangers fan was phoning in and saying that their key man for a game against Celtic would be John Lundstrom. His contract's running out at the end of the season. I'm sure there was probably a point in this season where there was Rangers fans that were thinking that, you know, maybe his time would have been up this summer, but Philip Clement, you know, confirming last week that, you know, they will do everything to make sure he's a Rangers player next season as well.
Yeah, I think it's important to get him tied down. I've got to say, I think that the Rangers manager, Clement, must take a big bit of the credit. I think since he's come into the building, Lundstrom's looked a different player, looked a player that everybody thought he could be. He's been absolutely excellent. I agree with Mark. I think that on Sunday, the middle of the park has got to be so, so important, because if McGregor is fit, that's really the strength of Celtic in there, creating for the front three. Obviously, with the pace of Maeda, Kyogo there, and probably Kuhn will play on the right-hand side. But that middle of the park, who dominates that, usually comes out on top. And Lundstrom will be a big part of that, and he's playing very, very well at the moment. So Rangers just need to get that balance right. That has got to be a real tactical battle there.
Craig, where are your confidence levels going into this? Are you feeling good because of the form Rangers have been under Philip Clement, or still maybe scarred because of the last couple of results this season?
No, I'm really confident. If I was making a prediction, I'd say 3-1 Rangers. Obviously, we didn't play the best the New Year game. But, you know, Celtic were hanging on. You know, even looking back, if you watch the highlights of that game, the fans are actually biting their nails. And, you know, when we pulled it back to 2-1, and obviously we had that, you know, penalty decision. That's actually another point I wanted to put across for you guys. I watch a lot of football, and I've been going to Ibrox since, like, you know, 95 or something like that, and I always used to laugh it off if Rangers drawing, it's like you come out the ground and, oh, who missed the penalty? But for me, you know, when I was a guy on last night or night before saying he would bet a grand that Rangers be awarded a penalty, I think it happened on the lead up to the Christmas game, New Year game as well. It was like, oh, Rangers will get a penalty. It's like, I don't go in for these conspiracy theories, you know, that you get in Glasgow, but this is one that I think most people with a rational brain can see. There's definitely a different narrative about Rangers penalties and Celtic penalties, you know, but both teams have had the same amount this season. I just can't get my head around that. And it's like, it always happens, it's into the referee's mind, oh, I can't award a penalty to Rangers this weekend because there'll be a full-on, not from you guys, but there'll be a full-on sort of like, I see, told you John Beaton to give them a penalty. It's just, I don't get it. It's like, as I say, I watch a lot of football, and for me, Rangers are probably one of the few clubs, it's like, why did they get a penalty? You know, it's odd, it's very odd.
There is quite a lot of talk when you come into these games about penalties and such, but when you actually look at the recent record, there aren't that many penalties given in Old Firm games, so you wonder how much of a factor it will play this weekend, if any at all.
Yeah, when I can't even think, when was the last one?
Well, if you're talking about the referee John Beaton, you've got to say that, you know, Celtic fans maybe be thinking, right, we'll bet a grand that John Beaton will give Rangers a penalty kick. Was it not that long ago he gave Celtic a penalty kick at Ibrox when Celtic went there and won? Because I think he's took charge, what, 5 games or something, but 9 yellow for Rangers, 11 yellow for Celtic. So I'm the same. I'm not buying into that. Rangers and Celtic get most
good penalty. Homework in it for him.
Yeah,
it's good homework.
You think so? I've been up all night.
Where did you get those stats from?
I was locked in the toilet when that was happening.
There has only been one penalty scored in the last 18 meetings between the side. That doesn't mean there's been one awarded, but there's certainly only been one.
But you've got to take into consideration, Rangers and Celtic will always probably get awarded most penalties because they're the teams that are always attacking. They're in the opposition box more than anybody else, and there'll be situation decisions. And we've seen the fact that now with the handball rule and everything, the penalty kick's been given, that sometimes we agree with, sometimes we don't. I hope we're not talking about that on Monday. I hope we're talking about the quality of football, because I've said it for a long time. Sometimes we get caught up too much in this fixture with the supporters from either side that the quality on the pitch isn't that great. I would like it to go different this week. I think we've just got a showpiece game. We know how important it is. I would love the two sets of players just to, you know, dishes up a fantastic game of football.
Well, thank you to Craig Ross, as a Celtic fan in Pollock. Up next, how do you view this one on Sunday, Ross?
Hi, Andrew, Mark, Gordon. Hope you guys are all well.
You too.
I actually think it'll be a draw on Sunday. Just what Gordon said, I actually think there'll be lots of goals. I think it'll be 3 each. I think the two teams are neck and neck this season. But from a Celtic point of view, this weekend it's a bit of a free hit for us, because Rangers are expected to win this because they're the home team and they've got all the fans. If Celtic lose this on Sunday, we've still got the opportunity to beat Rangers at Parkhead. If Celtic go to Ibrox and beat Rangers, Rangers then need to come to Parkhead and win, which is probably not going to happen because the majority of times Celtic win these games at Celtic Park. I can't think of the last time we get beat. I think it might have been 2019, the last time Rangers beat us at Parkhead. But for me, it's a bit of a free hit from Celtic this weekend if we win or lose.
Well, I think that's... I don't know if I've picked that up right, because if Rangers won at the weekend and they won against Dundee with their game in hand, they're 5 points in front. Yeah, am I correct in that? So they really don't need to go to Celtic Park and win. So I think that if Rangers beat Celtic at the weekend, you would certainly say they're in a strong, strong position. I think that's why it's important for both sides, because if Rangers can get that and go and beat, and Dundee's not a gimme, right? Because we've seen Dundee week in, week out. They're in the top six. They're going for the top six. They've got a good side. They've got a good manager there. They're playing very well. But you would honestly expect Rangers to go and win that if they beat Celtic, especially after the confidence. So if Rangers had to win that, I think it would put them in a very, very strong position.
I have to agree. I don't think it's a free hit at all, Ross. I couldn't disagree more. In fact, just the narrative around Celtic and Rangers from Clements come in, that Rangers are going one way and Celtic along the way are kind of stuttering and stalling, and that's been the stories that have been everywhere. And Brendan Rodgers has come out and he's had his say on it and saying that's not the case. And, you know, I kind of believe somewhere in between they're starting, but they're still hanging in there. They're not their best. If they have to go to Ibrox and lose, I think that it shows there may be a shift, you know, in where the title's going. I really do. And shift in momentum fully over to Ibrox. So that's why I believe Brendan Rodgers and the full Celtic team will be focused on this one and getting out there without getting beat. Now, if it's a draw, which I think it will be actually, and we'll get our score predictions probably on the day, but I think Brendan Rodgers says, fine, okay, it's another game that I've not lost. He's only lost one of these fixtures in his 15 meetings. So it's another one he's not lost. Rangers have then proved that they can't win, they just can't beat Celtic, and that's what they need to do. The opposite side, Rangers need to have a statement win over Celtic and this would be it. So I think it's crucial for Celtic that they don't lose it. It's crucial they don't think it's a free hit, that they go there with every intention of getting as many points as they can from that, whether that be one that might satisfy them, but certainly not being relaxed about the occasion.
Yeah, do you not see it that way, Ross, that if Rangers do get the victory, if you're saying it's a free hit, but then Rangers would go top of the table with a game in hand, even though there is that game at Celtic Park, would the momentum not shift in Rangers' favour, or would you still be confident that Celtic would be able to go on and lift the title?
No, I'm just thinking, obviously, that if Rangers win on Sunday and win their game in hand, it goes to 5 points. If Celtic then, and I know it's if, buts and maybes, if Celtic beat Rangers at Celtic Park, it brings it back to 2 points. And what's to say that Rangers won't drop any other points along the way? Now,
but then I suppose people would also say, what's the, you know, Celtic could also drop points. They've shown that they have dropped points outside of the Old Firm games.
That's the thing. It was, Ross, it was 7 points, remember, in Celtic's favour. If that then goes to minus, you know, 5 points within the space of, what, 4 months, 5 months, that is a huge momentum shift. And that, in a game that really matters as well, losing that one, you're finding yourself less time to clock back. And again, you have to think what that does for the opposition. Rangers win, you think of the mood about Ibrox, it's very unlikely then that they would take a step back. You know, they would then push on and go forward, whether Celtic, you never know how that would affect them.
Well, thank you to Ross. You can get your calls in 0141 951 1025 and we'll speak to you next.
You are the voice of Scottish football. Call 0141 951 1025. Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Gordon Dalziel and Mark Wilson in the studio with me, Andrew McLean, on tonight's Clyde One Super Scoreboard. Plenty of opinions already on Sunday's big game. Keep them coming. 0141 951 1025. You had a nice wee warm weather break, didn't you, before the big game, just back
camp
today?
That's it. Need to recharge the batteries, mate.
Feeling refreshed. Good, mate.
You're feeling good. Refreshed, jetted in, especially for the show. You know, that's how much I love.
That big red face is looking good.
It's actually not as bad as I thought it would be. Normally, when there is like cream a tiny bit of sun, you know, go sort of radiant red.
This God's honest truth, I forgot sun cream. And when we got there, we were out in the wilderness a wee bit, so there was very few shops. But luckily enough, it wasn't roasting hot, but it was great.
That's all right. You've had a nice, relaxing week. Gordon Dale's had a traumatic week that we will get to later on. He's not had a good time of it over the span of a few days, but we'll get to that later on. We'll go to the phones first. William is a Rangers fan. William is a Rangers fan in Stevenston. How are you feeling tonight, William?
Yeah, hello, Andrew, Mark, and Gordon.
Hi, William.
Yeah, I'm quite relaxed. I'm quite relaxed. Looking forward to Sunday. I was listening to the debate last night about who's an important player. For the first time, in my opinion, I'm going to give you a different slant on it, right? Squads is usually a big buzzword for these two teams, who's got the best squad. I think for the first time in a long, long time, Rangers have got a superior bench. I'm going to give you my reasons, right? If these guys don't start on Sunday, this is where I think Rangers could maybe edge in their favour. You've got Seema, you've got Mentondo, you've got McCausland, you've got Lawrence, you'll get Sterling. And one thing all these guys have got in common, they can all chip in with goals, you know what I mean? The two latter ones are very powerful, Lawrence and Sterling, and your Matondos and McCausland's receiver are lightning pace, and they can chip in with goals, especially Seema. I just wonder you think of that, guys, on the benches. I know the starting 11s are very good. I think Rangers, for the first time, I'm a Rangers man, I'm going to say this, I think they've got the superior bench.
Yeah, it's an interesting proposal. If we take a look at the benches from both teams at the weekend there, Celtic had Bain, Navrotsky, Ralston, Welsh, Bernardo, Kelly, Ida, Yang and Forrest. You'd expect that Callum McGregor will come back into the starting lineup, so that would mean Tomoki Iwata likely to drop to the bench in there. The Rangers bench from the weekend, McCrory, Sterling, Balogun, King, Raskin, Lawrence, Matondo, Seema, McCausland.
Yeah, well, you mentioned it, didn't you? The weekend that Rangers were looking particularly strong. I think that has been an area that they have been lacking in recent years, where they're starting 11 out in the pitch, not really much to bring on and affect a game in a positive way. But that seems to have sorted itself. Look, I have to agree with William. At this moment in time, obviously, both teams can maybe put up an argument depending on who starts, who's fit, who's dropping out. That Celtic team, if it's Iwata for McGregor, or, you know, if it's Palma or whoever, you know, for my era, I don't know. But certainly Rangers squad and attacking players, they've got options there in wide areas. By the way, a few weeks ago, it wasn't looking like that when they were picking up injuries and Seema wasn't back fully fit. McCausland had his injury. Sterling pulled up at Easter Road. You wondered if it would be threadbare again, but it came at the right time for Clement. He's got players back, and the interesting thing is who starts, who comes on. And with five subs, I said it earlier, that come about 60 minutes, you've got that option to change so many players.
Yeah, it's so much more crucial in these games now, isn't it? Since the introduction of the five sub rule and being able to change so many players and essentially change your system and bring on however many players, then it can impact the game massively.
Yeah, incredibly. Because gone are the days, if you're a sub, you're totally disappointed. You're disappointed not starting, but as a manager will take the subs now and say, look, you could be the biggest part of this team today. You're the guy that could come on and change it, the match winner, whatever it may be. And I think the subs are so, so important. I think it's important for managers how they use them, when they use them, how they read the game and how they turn the game for, you know, suit the to get the into their own favour of, you know, dominating the game. So it'll be interesting to see how that goes. But I did say at the weekend, I looked at the Rangers bench and I thought, yeah, they're getting back to their strongest squad. Clement likes the squad game. He likes to rotate. Now, if I look at tonight and everybody's fit, I'd be second-guessing Rangers side. You know, you look at Yilmaz, if he was fit, would probably come back in, right? Then the question marks, is it Cantwell or Lawrence? Will Wright start or will Sterling start there? Will McCausland? Would Seema come back in? He's been massive. So there's a lot of ifs and buts for Rangers because of what they've got. But if you look at Celtic, if McGregor's fit, I think everybody could pick Celtic's team. But let's not be kidding. Celtic have still got guys on the bench that can come on and turn games and win new games, especially in the wide areas as well. So I think both, I said it earlier, Andrew, at the top of the show, I think both teams are getting in a very good position.
I think what we have seen as well in recent months is two managers who aren't scared of changing at half time as well. So if the game's not taking on the pattern that they want, if they're not getting enough out of players, they will make changes in 45 minutes. I think back to Fir Park the other week there, with Celtic when they were struggling. Kyogo off, Ida on, Clement. Well, Clement didn't even wait, was it half an hour before he took Cantwell off in one game or something like that? So two managers not willing to hang about him, and you've got five subs and plenty of quality on the bench, it allows you to do that.
Yeah, well, I'm interested in Abdallah Sima. He was obviously back on the bench at the weekend, got around 10 minutes or so, maybe more than that with added time. Is he a player that you think, if he's fit, should be starting for Rangers this weekend, or with his injury issues, is he maybe more of an impact player off the bench this weekend?
If he's fully fit and he's a good week of training, he's a definite starter. But because he's been out that long, I'm not so sure. I think he'll go with Silva, right? Can I make just one quick point about the guys could maybe chew on this?
Yep, on you go.
Yeah. Brendan Rodgers, you've got to hold your hands up on this record. He's got an unbelievable record. But I might concentrate solely on the Ibrox games against Celtic, right? He's managed against managers, right, that have no been great. Rangers have been some managers that should even been manager of Rangers, right? There's one game that Rodgers came, and it was his biggest test. It was against Gerrard, and Rangers won 1-0, Ryan Jack. I think this time, because it's Clement, who's a fantastic manager, great tactician, gets the best out of players. I think this is Rodgers' sternest test as a Celtic manager going to Ibrox in this fix. So what do you think, guys?
I definitely think, obviously, you can say, well, Rodgers got the better of Clement at Celtic Park, but as William was saying, it's at Ibrox. I think the two guys in the dugout are very good managers and coaches. I think they know the game inside out. I think it'll be a brilliant tactical game. I remember when I was at the game and it was Brendan Rodgers went down to 10 men and Graham Murty, I think that's what maybe William's referring to. And Brendan Rodgers made a switch and brought on a centre forward. Was it Dembele or something he brought on, or Edward or one of the two? And I remember looking at Graham Murty and I can see the expression on his face if they say, I can't believe they brought on a centre forward because they've just went down to 10 men. And Brendan Rodgers went on to win the game. And I don't think that would happen against Clement. I think Clement is a very shrewd manager. I think he's getting the best out of the players. But I just think the two managers, they're experienced. Rodgers knows how to win this fixture. Clement's still to win it. But Clement has got Rangers firing on all cylinders just now. Everyone's playing for a team. He's got a good squad there, good match winners. That's why I think that, I said earlier, two teams are getting in a very, very strong and good place.
Because of the experience in the dugout, but also from some of the players on the pitch of Celtic getting the better of Rangers in more recent seasons, is it a bigger mentality test for Rangers this weekend than it is for Celtic?
I would tend to agree with that, yeah. I think Rangers still need that statement win over Celtic. I think when you look at the ones, I think, who was it? Was it Craig? The first caller mentioned it. The ones that they need to win, they've never quite managed it. In recent years, this is. And the one that they did win was meaningless, really, because the title's already wrapped up. This is a big one. This really is a big one. When everything's going smoothly and going the one direction for Rangers, if they have to lose this one, sort of derails a bit what they've done in the past, and especially for Clement.
your week almost got worse there. Gordon Dale almost just knocked a mug of coffee over the table.
I flew back for Ibiza for this. Anyway, you knew
I'm not going to the toilet, that's for sure.
Right, on that note, we'll leave William there. Thank you to William. Malcolm is a Celtic fan up next. Malcolm, what are you thinking ahead of Sunday?
I'm going to be neighbour near Gordon Dale. Lots for sure. I think he's in a week's this week.
Sorry, Malcolm, I didn't hear that. What'd you say?
Sorry, I'm saying you're in a week of weeks this week.
I'm not having the best of times, but I'm a strong character and I'll just build on it. I'll take the good with the bad and move on.
Exactly. Yeah, my point is, I want to pick up Mark on this whole narrative that momentum shifting if Celtic get beat at the weekend, and it's the club across the road that becomes in the driving seat. I would pose the question, but if Rangers did that one, we've heard this narrative year on year on year. At the start of the season, when the Messiah, Michael Beale, came in, it was going to be 6-0 Rangers because they were in such a good spot. After we beat them, with the worst team I've seen at Ibrox, he got sacked. Now, if Rangers didn't win, where does that put them? It's a must win for Rangers. Yeah, a must win for Celtic. Celtic get a draw, we're in the driving seat.
Does it work both ways at this point in the season, Mark, that essentially with so few games to go, whoever wins basically goes into the driving seat?
I think it's that simple. I think it just says moments ago, Rangers need the win because it's a statement win. They've not quite managed the big important games well enough against Celtic. So if they win it, sort of, if Celtic win it, derails all the good stuff that Rangers have possibly done under Clement at a crucial time of the season. I'll still stand by it. There is a momentum shift. The Celtic went from 7 points clear to Rangers edging that back, to overtaking them, to then, you know, Celtic okay are at a point ahead, to then winning this game. There is a momentum shift, and they could go then even further clear if they win their game in hand. I know that's all ifs and buts, but it's not that, you know, far beyond to believe that. Then that would maybe go to 5 points clear with few games to play. So it's at a crucial time of the season, Malcolm. If this was early on in the season, I certainly wouldn't be saying it was a momentum shift. It would just be another feather in the cap of a Clement. But when you've got so few games to go, I've been there before, and you lose one so crucial as this one, then it can be damaging to, you know, winning the title.
You're putting that in a Rangers perspective, but it's exactly the same with Celtic. If Celtic go and win this game or draw this game, the momentum shifts totally.
That's what I said, Malcolm. I said if Celtic win, that sort of derails everything good that Rangers have done.
Mark, everyone's in a Rangers perspective. The thing is, if Rangers going to win this league title this year, what's going to happen?
I don't know. You hear what I'm saying there? I'm saying if Celtic win, it derails everything possibly good that Clement's done.
Okay, well, that's the first time you said that. It's not about, oh,
I just said it four times.
Clement. So, let's put it this way. If Celtic get a draw this weekend, are they in the pole position to win the league?
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay.
There we go. Short and sweet. Thank you to...
I don't know where Malcolm was...
How do you say yes to that?
What?
If Celtic got a draw.
Get a draw.
Pole position, because if Rangers win their game in hand...
Is that because...
Because they've got a game to play at Celtic
games
Park.
Games at Celtic Park. Yeah.
Well, right, okay.
You disagree?
No, I think
you and Malcolm should get together.
Yeah,
then.
Me and Malcolm
you
are
seem to be in the same.
Me and Malcolm are friendly. I think that if Rangers win at the weekend, they're in a very, very strong position. I think if Celtic go there and draw, then I think we'll all be talking about the game at Celtic Park, because I think these two teams will certainly kick on, especially when the pressure's on. I don't see them dropping a lot of points. I know that you can look back and harp on about some of the disappointing performances that Celtic had at Celtic Park. You can look at Motherwell going to Ibrox and winning. But it's really the business end now. And I think these two teams will take care of anything in front of them after that. So then it would come down to Celtic Park. And you would probably think the Celtic are favourites at home. But if Rangers could win on Sunday and beat Dundee, it gives them that luxury of not, you know, they can afford to go to Celtic.
You were just questioning me there for saying Celtic would be in the pole position if they got a draw.
No,
and then just agreed.
No, I didn't.
He said, why would you say that?
I didn't agree with you. I said that.
But you've just said.
I said that if. My point is, if Rangers win the game and beat Dundee,
about
they're
Celtic
in the stronger part, then it would go down to Celtic Park.
And then you said for Celtic me, would be favourites.
Would be favourite, yeah, but Rangers can still go and win.
I think that's a roundabout way of you just agreeing with Mark, but
I'm
pretending
not
you're
Mark. Totally
anyway, I'll let the two of you bicker over the break. I'll
put him in the toilet, right, and see what happens.
Right, we'll get to that. Let me tell you about this first. Clyde One, live, celebrating the first 50 years. Yes, for the last 50 years, Clyde One have brought you some of the best and most memorable live gigs, and we're doing it all over again. As part of our 50th celebrations, we're taking over the Oval Hydro on Friday, the 31st of May, and we want you to be there as well. We've now announced our full lineup for it, featuring Amy McDonald, Tom Walker, Callum Beattie, Emily Sandy, and Texas as well. Tickets are selling quickly. If you want to secure your place before it sells out, get them at clydeone.com.
1-4-1-9-5-1-1-0-2-5. This is Scottish football's league leader, Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Mark Wilson and Gordon Dalziel with me, Andrew McLean, in the Clyde One Super Scoreboard studio tonight. Plenty of talk can build up to Sunday's game, but of course, if there's anything else you want to talk about, give us a call, 0141 951 1025. Plenty of discussions today about Dundee's pitch, with them playing Motherwell this weekend and then Rangers next midweek. There's plenty of discussions as well about Motherwell, potential US takeover as well, that looks to be getting closer. Might get onto that a bit later in the show, but I'm sure there are still plenty of opinions on Sunday's games to get through. You can tweet us at ClydeSSB. Douglas is on Twitter saying Rangers need players on the park that will immediately put a tackle in on Cameron Carter-Vickers and Callum McGregor. They need to shut them down straight away. He's identifying Rabbi Matondo as the type of player to do that. Can you see him starting this game?
I wondered last week when Matondo came on, and he scored, didn't he? A good goal. Yeah, with his right foot. And I just wondered if that was the... yes. And I just wondered if he was the sort of player that could cause a problem for Celtic. It's just that raw pace. But he showed he's got a final product as well, final end product. But you were saying last week, and
he won't start. No, he won't start. I think the big question mark for the Rangers manager is Seema, right? Now, I can take on both arguments. He's not played a lot of football. Coming off the bench, he'll give Rangers such a lift. Me personally, because of the excitement of the game, because of the game it is, I think he's such an important player to him. I would find a space for him. I would play him. And if I could get 60, 70 minutes out of him, fine. Because before he got injured, he was the main man. He was a threat. He was scoring goals. He was playing with such confidence. And I know the arguments about, well, he's not had a lot of game time and not be sharp. But Mark will tell you, he's played in many of these games. These games carry you. The atmosphere of these games carry you. You don't feel tired. You feel right up for this game. Whether he would play Seema and Silva off the two flanks rather than play right.
Because Seema has predominantly played off the left. That's where Fabio Silva's been playing. Yeah. Does that then, you know, does Silva shift over to the right? Does he play up front?
Problem.
And there's a question about Dessers.
Or you look at, for me, if Yilmaz is fit, I would play Sterling all day long. I think we talk about that midfield battle again, because Celtic are with Hatate back. I think Hatate looked very good at the weekend. I think he gets 65 minutes. With him back, and if they do bring McGregor back and he's fit to play, that's a strong area for Celtic. I would have guys like Sterling in there trying to dominate that. So I think the Rangers managers get a few big decisions to make.
Thomas is a Celtic fan in Coatbridge. Thomas, what are you thinking?
I've been listening to the rest of the guys that have phoned in and all that about how confident you are or no. I'm 100% confident. If Celtic put the right team on the park, which I think they will, which will be Hart, Taylor, Carter Vickers, Scales, Johnston, Hatate, O'Reilly, Iwata, Maeda, Kyogo, and Kuhn.
No Callum McGregor.
Too much for Rangers. No Callum McGregor.
Fitness reasons?
Iwata's been brilliant this year, I think. And there's only been two or three games that Celtic have struggled, like Kilmarnock. He got took off injured. We were winning 1-0 comfortably and we lost 2-1. We were bullied with two of the wee guys in the league, Armstrong and the other wee guy. The Hearts game, the last game there, they played a storming game other than the handball, the penalty that's given again them. I think Iwata's going to be an important player for Celtic this weekend.
Iwata over Callum McGregor. Iwata. You having it, Mark?
I would agree to some extent with Thomas. Iwata, I think he goes about his business quite quietly, but he's effective. I think he holds the middle of the pitch pretty well for Celtic. Doesn't he go chasing from side to side, and you need that within that structure that Brendan Rodgers plays with. But I think if there's a straight up choice, I think the Celtic manager, and me personally anyway, would always go for McGregor. I just think he gives more to the team. I think he plays passes forward quicker. And you're going to need that Ibrox. Although Iwata's done a good job this season, I still think you go for McGregor for these big important games.
I think Thomas makes some great, great points here. I was at the Kilmarnock game when Iwata got obviously come off injured, and he was terrific in the middle of the park. But, and I say the big but, getting into this game, the importance of it, and Callum McGregor's fit, let me tell you now, Callum McGregor is leading Celtic out at Ibrox on Sunday. 100%.
Is there any scenario where the two of them play together?
I've heard arguments earlier on this season for that.
I mean, they have played together.
McGregor plays a bit more advanced. But then who are you leaving out? You know, are you leaving Hatate out or are you leaving O'Reilly out? As much as O'Reilly's been hit and miss since January, outstanding the first half of the season, I don't think you can afford to leave him out. He's a big game player. And with Hatate, I would have Hatate in my team every single week. I think he brings so much to that team. I think it's about what you want going forward. Iwata very good defensively, but so is McGregor. But I think going forward, for McGregor to sit at the base of that midfield, to play those passes into Hatate or into O'Reilly or out wide to Kuhn or Maeda or whoever else, I think that's in his leadership.
And course, also on the McGregor, how many times has McGregor dominated these fixtures for Celtic, you know, throughout the years? He's been terrific. It's a good headache to have. It's a good choice to have. If he was leaving anyone out of the middle of the park, and I do agree with Mark, O'Reilly would be probably the one, because I think Hatate is a terrific talent. I thought,
even with him still getting back to full fitness, you think O'Reilly would be the one that would...
All day. I thought Hatate looked like he gave Celtic that sharpness back at Livingston again, and he looked sharp, and he's just a terrific player. O'Reilly's form's dipped a little bit, but where Mark's right, O'Reilly's a very good talent. He's a big game player. He could be a game changer. So it's a good headache, but I would go for the normal three if I was, you know, everybody was fit.
Thomas, do you think it's a realistic option? Can you see Brendan Rodgers doing that, or would you still expect Callum McGregor, if he's fit, to start over Iwata?
I'm just on the Iwata. I mean, we could see Callum McGregor. I think he's had any closed door minutes or anything on the ball or anything. I don't think he's played in any. So you're taking him out there, and this is going to be his first competitive game. He lasts 5-10 minutes, and you've got to change your game plan. I say you go with Iwata. You maybe get one or two up, because I think Kyogo's going to cause problems. I think Gilson and Suter are going to be looking for him on Monday when they're going to work again. I think Kyogo is getting a lot of hard press. I watch him every time at Celtic Park. I think the guy's fantastic. His runs are fantastic. We've now got Hatate, who's going to find his runs. You know what I mean? So I'm confident that we'll get a result at Ibrox on Sunday. Not a problem.
On Callum McGregor, I heard Marvin Bartley say it last night. You said it about Abdallah Sima. Adrenaline can carry players through this type of game, can't it? Would you expect that Callum McGregor, despite the fact that, you know, Thomas says he's not had any minutes behind closed doors or anything like that, didn't make an appearance against Livingston, that, you know, even if he's not 100%, he'll be able to get his way through this game?
Without doubt. I mean, we're not talking about Callum McGregor, who's been out for 6 months and had hardly any games under his belt. I mean, I don't know how many appearances he's had, but I'd imagine well over 30, probably 40 appearances this season. So it's not as if he's lost that much fitness. He'll still be sharp enough. If he's anywhere near fit, I'm with Daz with this one, he's back in the side, he's got the armband back on, and he'll lead the team out. And I think how important this one fixture is. If it's one earlier on in the season against Rangers, he might miss out, because there's another 3 or 4 to go, and the season's, you know, still got a long way to run. But this one is crucial with so few games to go.
With the amount of football Callum McGregor has played over the years, he's probably played in worse conditions than he's in at the moment as well, hasn't he?
If McGregor's fit, he's starting for me all day. I just think from his leadership, from the middle of the park, he knows this fixture inside out. Adrenaline will get him through. He knows how important the game is. I think you need your leaders on the pitch. You look at the difference when Cameron Carter-Vickers comes back to Celtic, they look better. You look at Hatate coming back, they look better. Callum McGregor's a massive part of Celtic, and I think that if Brendan Rodgers has him at his disposal on Sunday, I think he's playing all day long.
Well, thank you to Thomas. Plenty more of your calls to come, but first, it's time to play this.
Beat the Pundit with the Scottish Sun.
For the best football news and opinion online, thescottishsun.co.uk/football.
Well, we'll see if Gord Diehl is fit enough after battling a toilet door the other night for Beat the Pundit. We'll see if Mark Wilson is fresh off his holidays as well. 0141 951 1025. Your chance to beat the pundit is up next.
Tackle the headlines. 0141 951 1025. Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
into the second half of tonight's Clyde One Super Scoreboard. Plenty of calls so far on Sunday's big game between Celtic and Rangers at Ibrox. I'm sure we'll get plenty more tonight and plenty more tomorrow and on the open line on Saturday, and then 12 o'clock midday it is on Sunday is the big game. A couple of other talking points today, more drama about Dundee's pitch. Maybe you've got some thoughts on that. 0141 951 1025. Stuart Kettlewell has also been speaking about potential US investment at Motherwell. So any thoughts on that, give us a call or tweet us at ClydeSSB. But before that, it's time to play this.
Beat the Pundit with the Scottish Sun.
For the best football news and opinion online, thescottishsun.co.uk/football.
Yes, time to beat the pundit, take on Gordon DL or Mark Wilson for a chance to win a signed ball. I tell you what, they've actually, it's on my sheet in front of me, tells me exactly how the two of you have been getting on this season, right? And it says, Daz is second bottom of the pundits. And then the rest of the sentence goes, while Mark is the highest pundit. And then it goes on to the next line, without a 100% record.
Well,
It read as if you were the best pundit at it, and then it says without a 100% record. Roger, Roger, Andy, and Kenny all have a 100% record.
Three of them,
yep,
have they?
Yeah, three of them.
Kenny Miller get 100%.
Yep. By the way, 19 out of 19 this season. He's got 15 out of 15 for Andy, 10 out of 10 for Roger. You're 12 out of 16.
So it's still that's a good return.
19 out of 33.
33? I've got cramp.
Yeah, that is
playing beat the
that's
pundit.
Like Callum McGregor numbers of appearances that you've got there.
That's a poor return.
A lot of them I feel I was just unlucky.
Yeah. I think we get a higher calibre on a Thursday night though. I think
is it that, or you two are just a lower standard?
I would say I'm a lower standard. I'm not going to beat about the bush here.
You've undersold us there.
No. He's no bad. I'm on my day, I'm brilliant. But
right, let's see who you're up against. Ryan and Benidorm.
Ryan, that was just across the water for you. Just at Ibiza.
Ryan, how, spoiler night, how's Benidorm?
That's all we need to say. Hot.
You're just back from Spain
hot
as well?
Yeah, that was lovely. Very nice weather, it was. Yeah.
Ryan, hold on a minute. What time's it over there? 7 here?
8 o'clock.
8 o'clock.
So we're an hour ahead.
Right, come on, mate. And you're phoning Beat the Pundit in Benidorm. Go and have a big mirror and have a good look at it. What is that all about?
The big question is, are you as sunburnt as Mark Wilson?
No, but at least you're not stuck in a toilet, though.
You sound like you're...
who would you rather play then? The guy that got stuck in a toilet or the guy that's sunburnt from 2 days in Spain?
Listen, I listen to this every night of the week, and I've heard these two. I am not getting involved in who I would rather play. I can hear the two of them when they win.
Right,
have you got help, Ryan?
No. Well, the wife's here, but she's no fucking use.
Apologies if anyone in the live stream heard that. I hope we managed to get that off here on the radio. There's no way we're covering ourselves on that. But yes, apologies to anyone on the live stream, and apologies if that made its way on air. There was a bad word that slipped out from Ryan there. Oh, Ryan. What have you done to us? Oh, how are we going to regain our composure for Beat the Pundit now? Oh, dear.
Don't take anybody notice. Nobody noticed that.
Oh dear. I don't think so. You know what? We'll sail through this as if nothing happened. By the way, this is the second time in a matter of days that Mark Wilson and I have had tears in our eyes on air. We'll get round to that. That's fine. I am assured that it did not go out on the radio, but to those that heard it on the live stream, I'm very, very sorry. Right, let's move on quickly from that.
It'll be glad I came back for holiday just for that.
It'll be heads. Right. For Gordon DL.
Don't ask the wife, Ryan, remember.
Heads for Gordon DL, tails for Mark Wilson, and is heads for Gordon DL. Make sure he gets some greatest hits radio in his ear, and we'll maybe turn down their microphones as well so that the two of them can laugh amongst themselves. Right, Ryan, I'm sure you know the rules. It is 30 seconds on the clock. Answer as many questions as you can in that time. And remember, you can pass as well. Is that all good?
Yes.
Right, let's go. Who scored the only goal in the last Rangers against Celtic game at Ibrox?
Pass.
Dick Campbell currently manages what SPFL side?
Over.
Which English club connects Charlie Adam and Darren Fletcher?
Okay.
The Cattocks, the Wickers and the Black and Golds all play in which Scottish league? In which year did Gretna reach the Scottish Cup final?
2008.
Hearts' Callum Neuenhoff is what nationality?
Really?
Right. Have you two got a bit of composure about you? I'll can you hear us again?
I'll tell you what, he's getting a ball. I don't. he's getting a ball.
Dear. Right.
Right, go.
It might have thrown him off, and we'll see if it throws you off as well. Right, 30 seconds on the clock. Gordon DL, let's go. Who scored the only goal in the last Rangers-Celtic game at Ibrox?
Oh, Tavernier.
Dick Campbell currently manages which SPFL side?
East Fife.
Which English club connects Charlie Adam and Darren Fletcher?
Darren Fletcher?
Yep.
Blackpool.
The Cattocks, the Wickers and the Black and Golds play in which Scottish league?
One.
In which year did Gretna reach the Scottish Cup final?
2004.
Hearts' Callum Neuenhoff is which nationality?
He is French.
That was exactly the standard of game I would have thought that would have happened after an incident like that. Ryan, how did you feel it went?
Honestly, it's the worst game I beat the pundit I've ever given.
Yeah, it's maybe the worst as well. Right, let's go through the answers. Who scored the only goal in the last Rangers versus Celtic game at Ibrox? How did neither of you get this?
Kyogo.
Yes. I forgot about it.
Nil-nil. Dick Campbell currently manages which SPFL side? Gordon DL said East Fife. It is East Fife. 1-0 to Gordon DL. Which English club connects Charlie Adam and Darren Fletcher?
Stoke
City. Ryan.
Sure is.
Got it. 1-1. The Cattocks, the Wickers and the Black and Golds all play in which Scottish league? This is a tough one. You went for League 1. I think Ryan went for League 2. It's the Highland League. Brora Rangers, Wick, the Wickers.
Who's making these questions up? Ryan's missus.
In which year did Gretna reach the Scottish Cup final? 2006. Neither of you got it. It went down to the final question that you both got. Hearts' Callum Neuenhoff is what nationality? He's definitely not French. Ryan said Australian.
Austrian, is he?
Australian.
Is he Australian?
And Ryan said Australian.
Did I get beat there?
Yes, 2-1 to Ryan. So after all that,
I told you he deserved a ball.
Ryan wins. Ryan, how do you feel without saying any words that we can't broadcast?
I cannot believe Gordon DL's pal Andy Halliday on a podcast won me that question.
That was too close, Ryan. Right, I'm going to have to leave it there. That was way too close. But I was going to say thank you to Ryan. I'm not sure.
A phone call from someone in Benidorm at 8 o'clock and it does not sit well.
In fairness, that is maybe slightly on us, but also
not a bot. It was ready
not
to go
ideal. Not ideal.
His poor life settling.
So he's in bed. She's had to tolerate him all day. I'm gonna speak to him. He keeps swearing.
I might have insulted you live on air in front of everyone, but I got a signed ball out of it.
He deserves a ball, that man. I don't care about that loss. I'm quite happy with that.
That's good.
That just compounds what has been a terrible week for you, Gordon DL, because you've lost at Beat the Pundit.
Yeah.
If we go back and look at it in chronological order, the three of us with Hugh were on the show on Saturday.
What happened?
Surely you remember this because it's played on the show however many times this week.
Oh, I forgot about that.
Let's play it again.
No.
Wasn't he very mobile, was he, when he came back?
No, he didn't look fit at all.
Still baffled at how anyone's voice could do that out of nowhere.
Frog in your throat.
I actually thought for 1 minute nobody noticed, right? Until you, but blabbermouth, started shouting.
I think everyone was listening.
That wasn't a very good start.
No. And then Tuesday night's show rolls around. I think the show goes without a hitch. That's fine. 2 hours on air, no problems there. Gordon Duncan is then driving home from the show, gets a phone call from you.
Yeah.
He's thinking, what's this about? Gordon DL has locked himself in one of the toilets here at Clyde One HQ. Locked yourself in the toilet and you are panicking. You're not in a good way, are you?
No, because I'm claustrophobic.
Yeah. What's going through your mind?
I was in a good place how I was feeling because I was in a toilet. I'm thinking,
I'll ask
right,
no more questions about that.
I'm thinking, there's a window there. Can I smash that window? And then there's a hole in the ceiling. And I'm thinking, right, I'll climb up there and I'll get out. But the problem is, I panicked that much that I couldn't remember John, the producer's second name, in my phone. So I can't phone him.
Could you remember his first name?
John.
But yeah, at the time, could you?
Yeah.
Okay, that's a start.
So I then go for Gordon. By pure luck, Gordon comes back, right? I'm now in panic mode. I cannot get out the toilet, right?
Well, I tell you what, see, instead of you telling us, why don't we just listen to the whole thing right now?
What do you mean, listen to you?
Are you definitely stuck?
I'm close to full
there. The lock's falling off at this side.
Can you kick it in?
Hold on, I'll come with it. There you go. Right, stop it now. Let it go. That's it now.
Oh, mate. Oh, shit, man. Don't follow me, please.
I cannot believe that.
Using some of Ryan's favourite language as well.
Do you know, I'd have been okay if Roger Hanna was here, right? He'd have just ran headbutted it. He would have put that door in 2 minutes. Yeah, Roger's in there, like
the guy at The Shining.
Just grab a leg and an arm, just put Roger. Right, boys, come on, we need to get Dazzler out here.
Roger the battering ham. Hannah's going to be his new name.
Why are you so scared? The toilet's massive here.
But by the way, that's another thing, right? The toilet is, but it's a problem when you're in a situation that you cannot get out, right? It's locked. That's where I went into a frenzy. I'm no kidding you. I had to phone Gordon about 3 times that night. I was still at 10:30, still shaking. People don't understand. See, as a young boy, I get locked in a wardrobe, right?
We're now tapping into childhood trauma here, which is an area I'm not sure we want to go into.
My father, J.K. Rowling got inspiration from Harry Potter.
Locked me in my mother's cup when I was playing hide and seek, right? I was playing hide and seek. By the way, I was the best hide and seek guy in the world. Nobody could find me.
Because you couldn't get out because you're locked in.
I was locked in. I come out like Lily Savage, right? I was absolutely frightened. So that's been with me. And the minute that door, I knew that door, because that toilet's just been fixed. Honestly, I don't know what I'd have done. I would have started getting into meltdown. I'd have been trying to climb the ceiling, never putting the windows
in. I would never have expected to come back from Ibiza and heard a guy swearing twice and Lily Savage being brought up on this show.
Oh dear. Even better, the producer's telling me that the video of you stuck in the toilet is going to go on the Clyde One Super Scoreboard Twitter. I think it's just been posted now. So not only the audio that you get on the show tonight, you're also getting the video content over
you're really
at Clyde
claustrophobic.
SSB.
I've seen you don't go in the lift.
No, I don't. I walk up downstairs. I've got to say, I loved Gordon that night because I would have just thought to myself, he's panicking, I'd have left him.
What would you have done? Just curled up in the
I couldn't have climbed
through the ceiling. You actually I was thinking of the ceiling.
Yeah.
What? Did you think you were capable of climbing through the ceiling?
I had a look at the sink. I would have got myself
you
up in the sink.
Fitted through the hole in the ceiling.
I would have. And then I thought, right, what could I do to smash a window, right? Because I'm thinking I'm not really caring about Clyde building at this time. Right, I'm only They should have had that door fixed. And then obviously to get beat with Ryan tonight, it's just been a bad week, so... Sometimes you've got to take these on the chin and just move on, Mark, you know.
There we
We've
go.
All been there.
Pozog is having some fun on Twitter with your childhood trauma, saying the liar, the witch in the wardrobe. There we go. I like it. Right, let's go back to the phones. Craig is a Rangers fan in Whitburn. Craig, please bring us some normality. What is happening? What are you thinking about the game on Sunday?
I think Philip Lamont has had his first Old Firm. He's had a chance to see what he's going to come up against in person. It was the same with Ange. His first Old Firm didn't go too well, but he learned what he needed to do for the next one. I think if Rangers have someone touch tight to Kyogo and someone touch tight to McGregor if he plays, I think that's how you stop Celtic. I think in any Old Firm game that Rangers have put a lot of pressure on Callum McGregor, that's when they've had success.
I mean, it's easy to say, but I'm sure there have been plenty of games, Mark, where Rangers managers have gone into it and thought, we need someone on Callum McGregor, Kyogo, Celtic's top scorer over the last few seasons. We need someone touch tight on him. It's easy enough saying it, but executing it is very different, isn't it?
Well, it is. I mean, Man Martin players, I don't know if that's a thing of the past, maybe more prominent in your days, but what you have to think about, you put somebody really close to them and say, that's your specific job. Go and you do a job in Callum McGregor. What happens when you get possession? And say it as a Lundstrom, for talk's sake. Go and you play on McGregor. And Lundstrom, Rangers get possession, Lundstrom then gets in the ball. You know, you're always going to give up McGregor at some point, because if it breaks down, McGregor gets ball, picks a pass. People say, oh, well, why is he no man marking him? Same with Kyogo. I mean, how do you man mark Kyogo? I mean, he does most of his work within probably 40 yards from goal, pretty much stays in the centre zone in between those 6 yard lines. So it's not as if he's running everywhere, but it's the sharpness of movement. It's when you think you're concentrated on the ball and you've got Kyogo, and as soon as you look, his intelligence to go the opposite way, that's where it kills you. And he's been very good at it in this fixture.
I mean, you look at the two goals he scored just this season against Rangers. One of them is, you know, there's a mistake from Rangers in there, but the ball drops to Kyogo, first time finish into the bottom corner.
Yeah.
Rangers couldn't get close to him for that. And then the goal in the second fixture between the two, he actually doesn't have that much space around him, but manages to shift it onto his left and then finds the top corner.
He does, but I do think in the one he does score at Celtic Park, it's a magnificent strike, it's great movement, but I do think in that period, I think it was Goldson that sort of didn't go with him, he just kind of let Kyogo take that, and I think there must have been a thought in Goldson's head, is he's safe, he's got it 20 yards to goal, that's fine. So often where Kyogo gets in behind you from the penalty spot to the 6 yard line, that's where he's most effective, those cutbacks and first-time finishes. So maybe the argument was Goldson thought he'd done his job, but he's surely learned his lesson now. Kyogo coming short or dropping in deep, you have to go with him the full way, and the other centre-half has to make sure they cover the space behind you.
I agree with the man marking. I don't think that's the way Rangers will line up. I think what you've got to do for the important players is try to stop the supply. You know, if McGregor gets on the ball, there's got to be times because he drops deep. Don't let him get his head up. Don't let him make passes. I think that's what the information will go out for Rangers. Don't let him, you know, dominate the game from the middle of part. If he gets it, we need to be touch tight. We need to make sure that everything's played simple back the way. Kyogo's the same. You got to match his runs. You got to be switched on. You got to be clever. Celtic will be the same because Rangers have got players there that are clever players, that are good players, that if you switch off can hurt you. So Mark's right, the old days of the best player there, go and man mark him, we'll sacrifice this player for to make sure he doesn't dominate the game. They're gone. It's about shutting the supply and stopping the ammunition, especially for centre forwards like Kyogo.
Did you have another quick point you wanted to make, Craig?
Something that Rangers and Celtic fans have debated for years is that Rangers fans felt that Rodgers was only as successful as what he was at Celtic because Celtic had a squad worth 30 million plus. Whereas at that point, Rangers couldn't compete. Rangers were lucky if they had a squad that was worth 5 or 10 million pounds. Now, this is the first year that we've seen Rodgers come up against a decent Rangers team. And in my opinion, he has, in a way, bottled it so far because the start of the season, I don't think he can judge as much. I don't think Beale knew what he was doing. But as it went on, if any other manager apart from Rodgers had lost a 7-point lead, you would say they're bottling it. If that was Rangers, they'd be bottling it right now.
But let's not forget, it might have been a different team at the beginning of the season when Rodgers went to Ibrox and won. But he still beat Clermont in the most recent game. And Clermont was a decent amount of time in his Rangers' career. And Rangers were playing pretty well. Heard a lot of noise around about that fixture that this is going to be his first real test, pretty similar to now. Gets at Ibrox is a bit different, but I think it's a bit unfair to say Rodgers has bottled it. He's won the two games this season already. The previous ones, he can only beat what's in front of him, whatever his squad compared to Rangers looked like. And by the way, those games, they're not given, no matter how much you're more expensive squad you've got. But he managed through it, and Daz mentioned earlier, tactically, outwitted the others. So I think that's disrespectful to Brendan Rodgers to say that he's not come up against anybody really serious and this is his first test. He's already came up against Clement and won. This is a slightly different one, maybe slightly harder, but he's got a lot of good work behind him so far.
Is this just a time will tell type of thing? Because Brendan Rodgers has won both games against Rangers so far this season, could still win two trophies. No one will remember at the end of the season that Celtic were 7 points ahead and then went behind. If Celtic do end up winning two trophies at the end of this season, but if they don't end up winning trophies and Rangers get the better of Celtic in these next two games, then people will, you know, like Craig will say, Brendan Rodgers has bottled it. At the moment, it's
100%.
Can't really say either way, can you?
Yeah, 100%. I agree with Mark. I don't think Brendan Rodgers is that type of manager coach. I know he lost that 7-point lead, and I think a lot of credit must go to Clement in the way he came in and hit the ground running as a Rangers manager. Got a tune out of players that obviously Michael Beale couldn't, and he's progressed that with bringing in some good signings and tweaked one or two things. Of course, the league is so important. I think if Celtic had to lose it, I think Brendan Rodgers would come in for a bit, fair bit of criticism. Of course he would. If Clement had to lose it, I don't think he would get the same, because I think Celtic would hark back to, the supporters would look at the 7-point gap, they would look at the signings, you know, they'd pinpoint things like that. So I think it's important for Brendan Rodgers. But Brendan Rodgers in Scotland knows how to win trophies, knows how to win the leagues. But I just think that, I said earlier, Andrew, I think we've got two terrific managers, two terrific coaches, guys that are switched on tactically, and I think that's what makes it exciting at the weekend.
Thank you to Craig. More of your calls next, and we'll also set up a full-time teaser for the...
Taking your calls on Scottish football. 0141 951 1025. This is Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
It's been a nice, quiet Clyde One Super Scoreboard
great.
So far.
Enjoyed it tonight. Yeah.
Nice and quiet, beat the pundit. Nothing untoward Ryan. Happening whatsoever. Ryan having a nice time in Benidorm. Won his sign ball, and I'm not
wonder
sure.
Wonder what Ryan's plans are the night in Benidorm, eh?
Wherever it is, he'll go on his own.
Maybe just straight to bed for Ryan. I think that's for the best. 0141 951 1025 if you've got some calls about the football. But let's set up this for the guys first.
The full-time teaser with Universal Interiors East Kilbride, where their goal is a better wardrobe, slat wall, home office or media unit.
Yes, thank you to Nathan from Greenock for this one. We'll see how you two get on. Can you name the 8 players from Africa, North or Central America to score in an Old Firm game since 2010? So probably note that down. Africa, North America, Central America.
Sakala.
Fashion Sakala. Correct. May 2023, the most recent. You're looking for 8.
Carter Vickers.
Cameron Carter Vickers. Yes, of course. US international.
North America. Okay.
Decent start.
Aye.
Any more guesses?
No. Can you get any more? Central America.
Hold on.
Africa, North, Central America.
Africa, North. Oh, no, I've got to see Ruth, but it's not. Is it? Ruth won?
Jamaican international. Kemar Roof. Good shout. Yeah. May 2021. So there we go. I'll leave it at that. As usual, thank you to Universal Interiors, East Kilbride, on the full-time teaser. Email us your questions, fulltime@clyde1.com.
Right. Which Ruth play for?
Jamaica.
I come under Central America.
Yeah.
Does it?
On the map. If you just look at it.
Listen, I'm not taking geography lessons for you. It's the last thing we'll do.
Definitely correct. Right, he hasn't played for them for a while, but he has played in the last few years anyway. Right, let's go back to the phones. Graham is a Celtic fan in Wick. How are you tonight, Graham?
I'm fine, thanks. Yourself?
All good. How are you feeling about Sunday?
I'm feeling quite confident, to be honest.
What gives you that confidence?
Because the team has got to come out and perform on Sunday. If not, to be losing 7 points, coming into Sunday, losing Sunday, going to Parkhead, losing at Parkhead, Brendan Rodgers will be very, very lucky if he was doing a job at the start of the year then, next season.
I mean, Graham's saying there's a lot of pressure on Celtic, but is there as much pressure on Rangers? Is there more pressure on one team than the other, or do you think it's pretty even split?
I would probably say if Rangers had to win the game, they're in a terrific position. if they beat Dundee, right? And obviously they've got to go over a hurdle of beating Celtic and Dundee, because it would mean that they don't need to go to Celtic Park and win, right? I think if Celtic go there and beat Rangers with a game at Celtic Park, obviously, it would say, right, okay, we're in a strong position. But Rangers, if they beat Dundee again, would look at Celtic Park and think, right, okay, we can go there and it'll be decided on that. So there's always pressure in these games for me, right? Always pressure. I think two teams, two managers with the will to win, the desperate to get the bragging rights. Of course, Brendan Rodgers has been terrific in this fixture. Clement wants to get his first one under his belt. Of course he does. So I think that both teams begin with a bit of pressure on them.
I think with expectation comes greater pressure. And I think the Rangers fans expect them to win. As I said earlier on the show, I think with the direction of travel Rangers have taken over this season, from the disaster run about the September period to when Clements came in, and it's all going one way, building up to this point where you have a realistic chance of going top of the table and beating Celtic in a meaningful game. I think that brings huge pressure. Now, I get the pressure's heavy, of course, on Celtic's shoulders because of the blip they've had this season, because of the whole Brendan Rodgers season and that factor tying into everything and want to reclaim the title again. Of course it is, but I just think with the Rangers supporters in front of 50,000 there at Ibrox, the pressure may be heavier on their shoulders, but just minimal, you know, not great amounts, because the two of them know what's expected in these fixtures. But when you're going along and everything's building up to this peak, and if you lose it against Celtic, yet again the fingers will be pointed at the same personnel who have lost time and time again. I told you couldn't do it when it mattered, never mind all that stuff you've done in the past, and that'll be the response. So the Rangers players have to take that on their shoulders.
Graham, what's the key for Celtic to winning this game?
My point had nothing to do with you Rangers. All I've heard since that is you talking about Rangers. I'm not really interested in them, but I've sat and listened to you talk about them. That had nothing to do with my point that I was phoning about. I'm not interested in,
I suppose, the guys were just comparing the pressure. But if we just, okay, Graham, we'll take Celtic in isolation, yeah. Then. Has this pressure on Celtic built because of the way the league has gone so far this season, because of that point swing? Does that add extra pressure on Celtic? If it had been tight the whole way, is there extra pressure just because Celtic were ahead?
I think that does bring about its own pressure, because you're sailing along quite nicely and the season then all of a sudden turns. And of course the other team in this race then has to play a part in that, and you've got to say, when you look across and Rangers and Clement have won their games when Celtic have slipped up, of course that starts eking away at you. I always thought there was pressure on Celtic anyway throughout the season. Brendan Rodgers coming back split the fan base right down the middle, I feel, and he had a job winning those doubters over. Now when it starts so well, then again, yeah, everything's looking good. When you lose a few games, of course, when it gets to this stage, the games become tougher. But again, that can be alleviated. A win at Ibrox on Sunday, then, you know, the pressure, your shoulders relax a bit, you puff your chest out a wee bit saying, yeah, of course, we are still the champions. And that is possible. Let's not be kidded. That is possible. The players Celtic have got, the squad they've got, there's every possibility they can go to Ibrox and win that game.
To answer Graham's question from me, I think there's massive pressure on Celtic on Sunday. I don't think you can lose a game and give Rangers 2 points with a game in hand against Dundee, which possibly could be a 5-point lead. I don't think at this stage Celtic can afford to do that, right? I would fancy Rangers very, very strongly indeed to go on and lift the title. I know they've got a game at Celtic Park, and that's why I'm saying they could go to Celtic Park and lose a game and still win the title. So I think for Celtic to walk out Ibrox at the weekend, they can't afford to lose a game.
Graham?
Yeah, but Rangers didn't put us under any pressure. Celtic put themselves under pressure by losing and dropping points against other teams.
I suppose it kind of works both ways, though, because Rangers need to continue winning games out with.
If Rangers went about in the same pattern that they did in the first half of the season under Beale, then there would be no pressure. You know, Celtic could drop a few points and who cares, and there'd be no kickback and, just roll on to the next game. The problem is when you get a new manager in and they transform the team, and all of a sudden those difficult games you've got on paper that you think Rangers might slip in, up in, and they keep winning, of course that affects the full dynamic of the thing. And Celtic will be fully aware of that. Celtic players are, have been there before, and you look at the other team's results and you go, by the way, they're playing well. This is going to be a whole lot tougher than it was at the beginning of the season. So Brendan Rodgers, Cal McGregor, the rest will be under no illusions how difficult this tie will be. But I'll say again, they have got the players. If Celtic had a fully fit squad and everybody's firing on all cylinders, I still believe that they've got a better 11 than Rangers 11. Even though Rangers form's been good since come on, I still believe Celtic have got better players. And if they do perform, like Graham's saying, if they do turn up and perform at Ibrox on Sunday, I think they can win. But that's the problem. They've not done it all season. It's been patchy, in and out of form. You've never really got 11 players on the ball at one time going, wow, that was fantastic. Few and far between. If they can get it on Sunday, I believe they could win, but it's a big ask.
Confidence on Sunday. The same as our Celtic fans are as well. We're expecting to win. Why wouldn't we?
There's nothing up with that. I think both sets of supporters are very confident of winning. I think Rangers fans, 50,000 or whatever it may be going along there, will be expecting, you know, Rangers to go and win the game. I think Celtic fans are very confident that without fans in the ground supporting them, they know that Celtic can go and win this fixture. They've proved that in the past. I can understand why both sets of fans are totally confident that their team, because I said earlier, I think both sides are in a good place. I looked at them at the weekend. The only thing that I think would disappoint Rangers was the goal they gave up against Hibs. But they dominated the game. They looked good. Their bench was very strong. They get players back. You look at Celtic at the weekend against Livingston. Everybody kept on about for years and years. Livingston, a difficult place to go because of the surface. Hatate back. Carter Vickers back. Another game under his belt. I thought Celtic cruised that game, to be quite honest with you. I thought they eased it. 3-0, clean sheet as well. So I think, and obviously if they can get McGregor back, a big, big player for them, two of them getting in really a good place.
Graham, you'd said at the start of your call that, you know, if Rangers won, then, you know, you didn't see the rest of the season going well for Celtic. But the other way around, if Celtic get the victory, would you then expect them to go on and win the title?
Definitely, yeah, I would say so, yeah. Definitely. Even a draw at Ibrox, I'd be happy with. Even, but I don't usually go for draws, but if we happen to draw with them, fine. We'll get them at Celtic Park and give them a doing there.
I think, I said earlier in the show as well, I think a draw. I think Brendan Rodgers, although come out and say he wants to win, inside he wants to win, I think a draw is acceptable. I think either way, if Rangers had to be going to Celtic Park just now, I think Clement would be saying the same thing. A draw is not a bad result because it keeps you moving in the right direction. But it's a defeat. It could really derail things on both sides. So that's why this is building up to be one of the most eagerly anticipated fixtures we've seen for these two in a long, long time.
Well, thank you to Graham. Still a bit of time to get your calls in, but you guys have a bit of work to do on this teaser. Thank you to Universal Interiors East Kilbride for this, and Nathan from Greenock for the question. Can you name the 8 players from Africa, North America, or Central America to score in an Old Firm game since 2010. So far, you have Fashion Sakala, Cameron Carter-Vickers, and Kemar Roof.
Aribo.
Joe Aribo, no.
You know, score. Edu.
Morris Edu, correct.
I'm looking back. Is Wanyama back in that team? No.
No. I'll take one more.
Since 2010.
Yes, Morris Edu is the furthest Juf. Back. Elhadj Diouf.
He didn't score. Did
no.
He? No, no.
Did he not score?
We had him in our box.
Right, we'll get more of your answers next.
Number one for football in Glasgow and the West. 0141 951 1025. Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Into the final part of tonight's Clyde One Super Scoreboard. Still time for you to get your calls in. 0141 951 1025. And still time for Mark Wilson and Gordon DL to do work on this teaser. Can you name the 8 players from Africa, North or Central America to score in an Old Firm game since 2010? So far you have Fashion Sakala, Cameron Carter-Vickers, Kemar Roof, and Morris Edu.
One of my favourite
Oh, there we go. Mike's on
yeah,
now.
One of my favourite all-time players at Rangers, Scotty Arfield.
Scott Arfield, correct. I'll take one.
Man I played with, left back, scored the second worst goal in an Old Firm game by myself. El Kadouri.
Badr El Kadouri. Good shout from Morocco. Right, you have two to get. We will leave that there and go back to the phones and speak to David, who's a Rangers fan in Motherwell. What part of the week are you at, David? Are you nervous? Are you confident?
No, hello, panel.
Hi, David.
Ken McGarthy's all, apart from Matt Wilson, obviously.
Yeah, well done, David.
I wish Matt Wilson.
How obviously?
He's a Rangers fan, isn't he?
Oh, right, okay.
Yeah. I wish he was still playing for Celtic at this point, but.
So does 50,000 Rangers supporters.
By the way, David's also from Motherwell, so I'm amazed he's sending you any kind regards as well.
David
Gordon
probably knows me.
Aye, I do.
Do you, David?
Quite close to me.
Oh, do
you? Oh.
Yeah, I think the less said about that, the better.
Uh-huh. How do you know?
Listen, Rangers went to Seville to play Betis, and I was there, by the way, with my boy Cody, and they hadn't been beat for so long at home. And we had guys in the start lineup like Lammers, Cifuentes, Barisic, McCausland. That's four players that Rangers fans don't want to see in the team on Sunday, which that's probably four players that won't be in the team on Sunday. And we still beat a quality opposition away from home. So I honestly can't see anything other than a Rangers win. I think we'll bath our Celtic on Sunday.
I know Lammers didn't start that game, but after that game, Rangers went to Celtic Park and lost 2-1. So does that change your confidence levels at all?
No. Obviously, playing two games a week and then Celtic had a rest, that's played a big part of that. And picking up the two games, you'd rather win the Betis game because we went through the next round, obviously, and still had a chance to catch up with Celtic. But Celtic haven't been in any great shapes this year at all. We started off terribly because we had Michael Beale, but now we've got Clement. And we've got all the players coming back. Celtic have got players coming back as well, but are they going to be fit? Rangers have got a better squad, 100%. Rangers will battle Celtic on Sunday.
Well,
that's confidence.
Yeah. David, just on the you said there about Barisic, if Yilmaz isn't fit, who do you think will play at left back then? Sterling?
I'd love Sterling to play left back guy. Barisic isn't he a quick fit anymore? Obviously, he's signed for another team next. He's not going to get injured or whatever. But he's not been great in these big games the last couple of times. So if Yilmaz isn't fit, no, definitely Sterling.
Do you feel Rangers are a much different side from the one that lost at Celtic Park, then, David?
No, much different, but...
So how does it go from Celtic winning that game 2-1 to Rangers then battering Celtic on Sunday?
I don't think Celtic were great that day. We were just kind of underperforming, you know what I mean? But... Rangers have definitely got a better squad now and got a bit of kind of momentum. That international break sort of came at the wrong time, if you will, but obviously we've got players back, Celtic get players back. I'm glad Rodgers is going to be in the dugout. I'm glad Callum McGregor's going to be back because there's going to be no excuses for any side. I think it's set for a good game. It's set for goals. But once I say that, it's probably going to be nothing each.
David says there's going to be no excuses from any side. I can guarantee that no matter what side loses this game on Monday night, we will be hearing excuses from the losing side. But either way, David is confident Rangers will batter Celtic. We've had Celtic fans on the phone tonight that have been 100% sure that Celtic will beat Rangers. Are you surprised that there's those levels of confidence at all? Or do you just expect that and...
Nothing changes. You get, you know, a bit of extremism from both sets of supporters that they can see no fault in their own team and they don't see the other side putting up a challenge. But I think it's crazy when you look at the league table and you look at the form of both sides and where they are sitting with nothing between them that you can just disregard the other and say, oh, we'll go out and batter them. And equally for Celtic fans, 100% it's going to be a victory because Rangers are this, that and the next thing. You know, I wonder what supporters think that the managers and players of each team and opposition team think each other. You think they're that flippant with their approach? If they were, it'd be hugely unprofessional. They understand in the dressing room what the challenges are and where they both are in the league. They know it's going to be difficult. These games are run very tightly over this season alone. 1-0 in the first game, 2-1 in the second game. By the way, I did think the second game, the one Kyogo scores, I thought it was a terrific game of football. I thought both teams showed what a good spectacle it could be, rather than the drab affair that we usually get served up. So I hope for a game like that. But on their day, both teams can beat each other. And I made the point earlier, for me, still Celtic, if everyone's fit and firing, have got a better starting 11 than Rangers. However, it's been the case this season that Celtic haven't had everybody fit, or even when they have, they've not played their best stuff. Rangers could argue the same. They've not had Sima for a large part of the season, and others firing, and Dessers is getting up to a level now, but they've never really had Dessers and Sima firing at the same time along with Silva. So who knows if those three play up front, what that could look like. That's what makes it so fascinating.
Mark doesn't want to see a drab game, but do all the elements kind of play for this being quite a cagey match, just given what is at stake, and you know, a defeat for either side could be really, really telling to where the title goes this season. Can you see it being a really, you know, cagey match where there's not a lot of risks taken?
Yeah, well, it could be. I'm hoping it's not. I'm hoping with David that we're getting plenty of excitement, plenty of goals, plenty of talking points, because I think this game will deserve it. But I've watched many of these games. We've built them up throughout the week, and the quality on the pitch has been really poor because, you know, two teams that are, you know, going head to head, very closely matched, it becomes a tactical battle. I just think there's flair players out there just now that can turn games for Celtic and Rangers. I think we will get an exciting game. I think we will get goals. To call it is very hard. I'm not surprised that David's on here saying, yeah, no, we're going to batter Celtic at the weekend, because every Celtic fan will be saying the exact same as David. We're going to batter Rangers at the weekend. We know how to go there and win. That's the beauty of this game. It's all about the excitement. It's all about the build-up. But the proof of it will be at 12 o'clock when the two teams come out and they have to go head-to-head.
David, who's the key man for Rangers this weekend, do you feel?
I actually feel like Goldson. Like, once he's on his game, and we're solid at the back. But I do feel, on the other hand, if Celtic win, they'll win the league. If we win, it's not guaranteed, because until we win that game at Dundee, and then we've also got a game at Parkhead. But I think if Celtic win, that'll just give them confidence, and then they'll go on to win the league, because they'll go in front. Like, even with a game in hand, we kind of go top. But
I thought you weren't considering the possibility of a Celtic win, David.
No, not at all. No chance. No, I can't see. I just think it's all about attitude, and Philip Clement seems to have the players concentrated and focused, and everyone knows their job. Even Cantwell, and every player is not guaranteed a spot in the team, so they're fighting every week to get there, you know what I mean? So yeah, as I say, I think we'll battle Celtic.
How will the players and the managers be feeling right now?
Well, Brendan Rodgers and lots of the Celtic squad know this fixture, know what to expect. I think they'll be pretty calm. I think John Kennedy alluded to that at the weekend. Clement seems a calm customer as well. We've got to say, I think David's spot on there, where he says he's got that Rangers team focused and pulling in the right direction. Everybody knows their job. So I think he'll just go about his business the same way he's done for all the previous games and the European games. But they'll be aware that this one's a wee bit special, you know, and what's riding on it and what it can mean for both teams if they come to lose on Sunday.
Right, thank you to David. We better finish off this teaser. Can you name the 8 players from Africa, North or Central America to score on an Old Firm game since 2010? You have Fashion Sakala, Scott Arfield, Cameron Carter-Vickers, Kamar Roof, Badr El-Khadouri and Morris Edu. Two more to go.
I'm struggling.
You have one Celtic and one Rangers. The Rangers player from May 2012. Celtic player who the nationality you think he is, he changed and now plays. So it is a tough one. Was French, played for the French youth teams and then moved on
Edward.
To no, no, but similar era. Cameroon, he played for.
Midfield and Cham.
Yes, Olivier Cham for Rangers. Winger. Nigerian.
I've not got a clue.
Nothing.
I don't know. I would have
also played
against him.
For Aberdeen.
Sonny Aluko.
Sonny Aluko. There we go. Thank you. to Nathan in Greenock for that question and to Universal Interiors East Kilbride for the full time teaser. The build up does not stop there for the big game on Sunday. We're back tomorrow night from 6 o'clock with Kenny Miller and Simon Donnelly. Remember, if you want to catch up on the show, you can listen back wherever you get your podcasts, or you can watch the whole thing back on YouTube, Facebook and Twitter by searching Clyde One SSB. And stay right there, because it's Callum Gallagher up next.